interesting. I know you're a big shot in terms of your superstar actor and all that type of stuff. But I think, yes. But, you know, it's kind of interesting. The most powerful thing about you is your humanity and the amount of love that you have for people. Your passion and desire to empower people and to leave the world a better place. I think that's something that's very, very impressive. And, it, you know, it inspires people throughout the world. And we have another generation of young people coming up. And it's so important now more than ever to encourage them to think not only about themselves, but about other young people, you know, in other parts of the world, and to see and believe that they can be change makers, that they can actually impact the world just by having a desire to really make a change. Now, I just want to ask you, what are some of the things that you're most passionate about right now?
Well, there's so many things on my plate. I'm passionate about education. I'm on the board of a really imaginative project called the Algebra Project. And it started by one of the great civil rights leaders in my country, Robert Moses. Robert Moses, Bob Moses, as most people remember him, was one of the architects of Freedom Summer 50 years ago, 52 years ago now, in which young people came to the South and they had freedom schools and they registered people to vote. It changed the whole complexion of the civil rights movement. They used voting, the right to vote, as a tactic, not an end in itself, but a tactic. So I get a chance to be around Bob Moses, who's 81 years old, and just to sit in and just wonder, man, because he was when I was 16, I knew who Bob Moses was, because he was one of my heroes. All those young people who weren't that much older than me, were leading the civil rights movement in the South, in Mississippi, in Alabama, John Lewis, who's a congressman, in North Carolina. All those people were my heroes, the people I looked up to when I was young. So I'm passionate about education and all the issues around justice. Because justice, when you talk about education and frame that, justice becomes right in the realm of what we mean by education. We're looking at the way African descendants live. This decade is the decade of the Afro-descendant. So what we can do and talk about the issues around Afro-descendants in this region. There are over 200 million people of African descent in this hemisphere. Over 100 million of them live in the country that my son is from, Brazil. They live in Colombia. They in the Caribbean, they in Canada, they in America, they in Bolivia, Africans in Peru, they in Ecuador, they in Venezuela. They are all these Afro-descendants. That's an important moment. So I'm passionate about that. The UN has defined that or designated that this decade from January 2015 to December 31st, 2014 as the decade of Afro-descendants. How do we use it? How do we use it to look at the index of how African descendants' life are? Education, healthcare, job, well-being, housing, all that. How do we look at it? 90% of those over 200 million Afro descendants live below the poverty line. That's real. Mm-hmm. Not hyperbola, not something that I'm making up, but that's real. What do we do about to get the world to pay attention to that?
Wow, that's amazing. That's a lot of work.
Well, it's all because there are people doing it. And remember, I've been meeting with groups of Afro-descendants since the World Conference on Racism in 2001. You know, whether they've been in Peru, whether we have a summit, whether it's been in Cuba, we've been meeting with Afro-descendants and talking about the issues around Afro-descendants. I cannot just talk about myself as an African-American. Mm-hmm. That's too limiting. It doesn't give us the kind of thrust that we need to talk about the issues of Afro descendants in the region. And the problem is, and I'm only following the models set up by others, Du Bois, who wrote The Souls of Black Folks. Who's read The Souls of Black Folks? Souls, one of the most important books, one of the most important books of the early part of the 20th century. It was written in 1903. He was arguably W.B. Du Bois, who was born in Great Barrington, Massachusetts in 1868. Mind you, listen to the time. He died on the eve of the March on Washington in August 28th in Ghana, 1963. So he spanned, his life spanned 95 years. He is arguably the father of modern sociology with his study of the Philadelphia study of 1895. He's the first graduate, black graduate from Harvard University with a PhD. He is one of the most remarkable intellectuals and radicals of the 20th century. He and Paul Robeson, one of the great artists that so many of us followed in as footsteps, one of the great artists who spoke 12 languages fluently, sang in more than that, and was a brilliant actor, a brilliant scholar, and someone who worked on behalf of justice, whether it's for labor unions and people's rights and workers, whether they're white workers, black workers, and all of these are the people who have informed me in terms of where I'm at. But I said all that to say that we've talked about Afro descendants. At the beginning of the 21st century, one of the founders, W.B. Du Bois, was one of the founders of the NAACP, the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. He, along with Ida B. Wells, at the Niagara Movement, they had right here at Niagara Falls, they had a movement, a meeting, and called it the Niagara Movement in 1909, mm-hmm. and they formed the NAACP. Mm-hmm. All these are real marks, benchmarks, mm-hmm. in the evolution and development of African-American thought within the 20th century. Garvey, Marcus Garvey, as we all know, is a part of that, and others are part of that thinking, of the thinking and the way in which we have been able to organize what to do, how we see ourselves in the world. And that's important. So history is always important, because you don't come out, you don't live in a vacuum. This history you live at this particular moment, these items that we use, the cell phone, computers and everything else, before that, there was thought before that. There were ways in which people access everybody. I'm telling you, you take this. When I met Walter Sisulu, who I consider to be the moral center of the ANC, he said that in the 30s, in the 1930s, he would meet with not only intellectuals in Africa and movement builders in Africa, but African Americans as well in South Africa in the 1930s. So this connection of people happened long before there were cell phones and everything else. We have to understand that, and the history lays this out. Not only was the great radicalism happen among African Americans, it happened among people around the world. And the generation that I come out of, the generation which I'm a part of, is a part of the extended part of that. We didn't invent the wheel. We tried to do what we do to complement what others have done before. In a sense, as an artist, the people that have been close to me for my life and my great friends, Harry Belafonte is one of my great friends for the last 35 years. Ruby D and Ozzie Davis, one of my great friends for the last 25, 30 years as well. So these are the people who had enormous influence on me. Not what they said, what they did. How they tried to connect African descendants, you know, from around the hemisphere and in the Caribbean, Brazil, and everything else, connect those two. It's always finding the connection point. I was at the restaurant right here, and I just met a young man who was from Angola. I remember the fight for the struggle for decolonization in 1973, 1974, 1975, until Angola was freed, given its independence, and immediately came under attack from the South Africans who came up, and the Cuban troops came in and defeated the South Africans. First time the South African troops had ever had a defeat, particularly by Africans and African descendants. And most of those troops who came to Angola can trace their ancestry from Angola. They're over 200 million Afro-descendants. We have to know what they're doing now, how they're shaping this and shaping their lives within in the 21st century.
So, you know, that's a lot of information that you've given us. And I was just thinking, you know, for the ordinary person living in North America, what are some of the key things that they can do? You know, for the most part, people are busy trying to raise their family, trying to earn a living and that sort of thing. And their time may be limited in what they are able to do or how much you're able to contribute. But what are some of the basic things that you think we as individuals should know? And what are some of the things that you think that we can actually do to have an impact, to make some sort of an impact?
For me, the first, without a doubt, is the role we play as citizens. Not simply to vote for those who are able and old enough to vote, but the role we play in understanding what is happening in the political structure which dictates our life. Who we vote as the dog catcher is important. Who we vote to the school board is important. All those people make decisions. And the decisions they make have to be decisions that enhance our lives, the systems that govern our lives. So the most important part is citizenship. And it's the first word I remember from my third grade teacher when I was like 8, 9 years old. Well, she said, I'm not just in the business of making good students, I'm in the business of making good citizens. Wham. Here's a woman saying that, a third grade teacher, a black woman saying that in 1955. What's happening in 1955? The Montgomery bus boycott, the civil rights movement, Brown versus the Board of Education, which ended de facto segregation, ended de jure segregation, you know, not separate but equal, which had been the law of the land since 1896. Had been the law of the land in the United States for almost 60 years. But now she's saying, we need citizens right now. We need citizens, because we need citizens to talk about climate change and global warming, the fact that the impact that has on underserved communities, the fact that impact that it has on what we call environmental racism. There is environmental racism, you know? Think about Fort, I can't think of the place up in Canada where they're doing the oil, excavating the oil there from shale. Huh? Tar sand, from the tar sand. Think about that. Think about what's happening there in terms of just that. The impact that's happening on people's, First Nation people's right, First Nation people's lives. So I think that the first thing we have to respond to is who we are as citizens. And what does that mean? If that means being active, there's so many things that we have in our lives and so many things that we have to do on a daily basis. But what does that mean? What does citizenship mean in a sense, in a dynamic world? And it changes. For citizenships and what it meant to Bob Moses in 1961, when he joined the Student Violent Coordinating Committee, and there were men and women who was as young as 18 years old, 17 years old, 16 years old, who were part of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. So, but what does that mean to citizen? And how do we exercise that in our communities in terms of paying attention and being informed? And when we talk about a democracy, Alexis de Tocqueville, the great historian, French historian, would say when he came to the US, he says, this system of democracy is a very interesting concept, but it only works with informed citizens. So we have to have informed citizens. And you're not gonna look at Fox News or any other kind of CNN and become an informed citizen. You have to find other information sources to be an informed citizen. And they're there. They're all over the website. They're all over the internet. They're all over social media. Different ways of being a citizen and consider yourself. That's the most important thing. How you extrapolate out of that, what it means to you individually, it's up to you. But it means that not to be informed and to be active, not just on election day, is critical for the change, the real change to happen, you know? And then we may have a chance. We may have a chance to save the planet. We may have a chance to save humanity. And we got to think bigger than that. We're not just simply saying, we got to save humanity. The fourth grade teacher, I was in Detroit, Michigan. Detroit's not too far from here. Detroit, Michigan is the home of modern industry, but it's the poster child for deindustrialization. You know what my deindustrialization means? That all the jobs that were in Detroit 50 years ago are now somewhere else, in Saipan, overseas, Mexico, and everything else. That's what deindustrialization. Well, the population in Detroit in 1961 was about 1.3 million. Now is less than 700,000 because people had moved out from the center there. So we had to understand that. I went to a meeting in Detroit and a group of organizations in Detroit. Fourth grade teacher said the first thing that he asked his students, the first question he asked his students at the beginning of every year is, what does it mean to be a human being? It's the first question of philosophy. The second question of philosophy is, how do you know? That's the second question. So what does it mean to be a human being is what we have to question. What does it mean that we have to be a human being? What's happening to black young men and black people, which sprung, came out of that Black Lives Matter, you know, which is not just in the United States now, it's in the UK, it's in Brazil, it's everything. Black Lives Matter, it's here too. What does that mean to be a human being, in a sense? What does it mean to a human being when we see what is happening to, has happened historically, to First Nation people? What do we see, what does it mean to be a human being when we see what is happening around immigration, particularly in my country? But migration is a major issue around the world. And border, quote unquote, border protection. You know, we have a candidate talking about building a wall between the United States and Mexico. Did he know that California used to be part of Mexico? That New Mexico used to be part of Mexico? What do you mean? That Arizona used to be part of Mexico? You know, all of this. What does he mean by this, in a sense? And how do we fight that arrogance, not only arrogance, and sense of entitlement, and sense of privilege, and racism? Not only fight that, how do we kind of respond to it? And what are the things that we do? How is our voice heard? Because if our voice ain't heard in the mixture, there's no way we can make the changes necessary. And we got a chance. Mm-hmm. I'm saying that you got a chance. Venezuela had the best election. This is from Jimmy Carter and the Carter Institute. The best election in history. Transparency, the fact that 80% of the people participated in everything else. All of that stuff, the best election system in history, he said. And yet at the same time, my government said that it was a dictatorship. Not a free election, but people had a choice to make. But they were trying to do something else because they were trying to undermine the will of the people. They were trying to undermine the whole idea of participatory democracy. That's what we got to get to. If we have a chance, it is through that process. If we have a chance to alter, to change the systems which dictate our lives, which inform our lives, it is through that process right now. We have that available. Don't abuse it. Don't misuse it. Don't neglect it.
For the young people here, one of the things I think about in terms of helping them to have some type of guideline, some type of vision for themselves that will keep them on track. With regards to your life, what are some of the things that you held on to that allowed you to, you know, go through the storms and persevere and not give up?
Well, I worked in city government for 6.5 years, and I mentioned it early, after I finished university. And I mean, I could have very well been retired now. Yeah. I'm very retired. You know, I came to the Model Cities program in 1971. And look here, that's I know it's in the playground. That's 45 years ago. I should be retired and everything else. But I tell you, just trying to feel the challenge of getting a grasp, you know, of what is happening to you? What is happening around you? I mean, there are ways in which I can deconstruct the industry itself, storytelling, you know, and we've tried to use, with my company, to try to use a platform. And I think pretty much when I've had an opportunity throughout my career, a platform to do projects that I think have historic meaning, that have some sort of purpose around justice and understanding, I think those are the things that I think are important. But I get a chance to talk to young people. That keeps me grounded. I get a chance to talk to young people when I think that, man, you know, when I need to get a job, you know, I need to get a job too. Well, I tell you what I say, all this hyperbole about being a star and all that other kind of, throw all that under the table, man, and I just get a job, you know? I think about the same things than anybody else. You know, how you gonna pay for college education? How you gonna do this? What is gonna happen to your children after they graduate from college? I mean, those things are on the wire. What are the ways in which you can impart something, watching them grow? It's the most beautiful thing, you know, to see. You know, people, young people, children grow into adults. You know, it's a remarkable translation of life, man. It's so incredible. I was just at some event where I just saw these young people, and you, 'cause you remember when you were there to some extent. You know, and how all the things seems larger. Seems like your body is growing faster than everything. I remember that moment looking like, what's wrong with my body? I can't, because it's growing all out of the place, you know? I remember all that, you know, in the sense of that, and trying to come, but it's just knowing that you can weather and get through those obstacles, you know? When I've had to talk about, you know, young people, even the fourth grade or third grade or second grade, I go and talk to, read stories to kindergarten. You know what I'm saying? In a sense, I've always tried to think about from the vantage point of each step that they make is a transformative step. Each thing that they learn provides the kind of ammunition and the tools that they need to take the next step. So everything that you're learning at the moment, that's just not kind of thrown to the wind. It's a way of you accumulating so much. All my stories are accumulation of all that. My memories of my grandparents, my memories of my parents, you know, the moments, you know, that I remember, you know, of my father, my mother, you know, the things that they said, those are all tools that I use. The watching my grandmother move around and watching her, and couldn't figure out why I trailed, whenever I went to the farm, why I trailed behind her all the time. Then I realized that's what I did when I was a baby, when I was at the farm. And why the smell, when I come to the farm, there was a certain way in which my sensorial mechanisms came alive, the weight of the heat. All those things that I've been able to remember. Now, I've had a life that I've had a framework when I've been able to contextualize those and put it in some sort of context. When I did Places in the Heart with Sally Fields, my mother had died in an automobile accident the same day that I was told I was going to get the role. And all I did on Sally Field, God bless her, she helped me, because I cried. I was crying when I came to the set. I was crying on the set. I was crying when I left the set, you know. And so, using that as an opportunity to dedicate my work to my mother, you know that. Or I did a movie, a Mexican movie, where I'm traveling around with a pig or all around Mexico that's coming out in the fall. And my grandfather was a pig farmer. He was a farmer. He grew pigs. In a big group of pigs. And whenever, I never thought he paid attention to me till I was about 33 years old and I was living in New York, starving like Marvin. You know, trying to do something like Marvin. You know, we'd all starving in New York together. I was starving like with Sam Jackson, starving with Denzel, starving with Morgan Freeman, starving with Delroy Lindo. We were all starving together. in the late 70s and early 90s, in 1979, and they tell you, any of them tell you, they weren't starving. They, you know, we were all starving. My mom sent me down there, said, go help your grandpa out, man. And I never thought he paid any attention to me. I go down there. I think the last time I seen him was when I was 23, I drove across the country with my girlfriend. We argued the whole time we came across the country, and we broke up when we got back. my grandma said, these people are crazy. I hadn't saw Simon when I went down there. I was like, that's 32, 33. And my mom said, go down there and visit. Go help your grandfather out. And he said, you know, and I see. So I come around there. I help him build a septic tank, refinish the hardwood floors, put tile on it. And he just came down there. The first time I thought he paid attention to me. And I figured it out. He thought that maybe he got a farmer here. So, so he asked me, so son, what you do? I said, I'm an actor. And he looked at me with a blank stare. He didn't know what I was talking about. You know, it was funny, yeah, you know, and so it's funny, but those are kind of experiences that are precious, you know, that's part of the journey, you know, to be part of the journey, your journey, you have to remember Monday and connect it to Tuesday and connect it to Wednesday to Friday, and then take that year, and then connect to the next year, and the next year, and the next year. It's all cumulative. You know, when I came in this bookstore, the first thing that made me feel comfortable are the stories. Where's black skin, white? Where's Black Jacobins? I read that in 1971, that book right there. That right, Black Jacobins right there. It was the story of the Haitian Revolution. Written by one in 1939, one of the greatest theories, Marxist theories of history in the 20th century, C.L.R. James. About the Haitian Revolution and the French Revolution, the connection analysis of that. Or Black Skin, White Mask, where's that? With Frantz Fanon. I read that when I was like 21, you know, years old, trying to figure out. Or Wretched of the Earth, read that was 20. Or Miss Césaire, the great Martinican poet and writer who was a mayor forever of Port-au-Prince in which call. Or, you know, Leopold Senghor, or my hero was my first hero, I think, and the reason why I majored in economics was because of the great, great liberator and the first president of Tanzania, Julius Nyerere. Julius Nyerere, the teacher. The teacher. A lot of us wanted to go to Tanzania and work in 1967, 1968 after we graduated from college because of Julius Nyerere and his concept of African development, African socialism, Ujamaa. Villages, read his books and connect it to now. They're just as relevant now. If they are relevant, if they're even more relevant, they're part of a process of evolutionary thought. And I said evolutionary thought, the thought of how we can develop, how we can be self-sufficient in developing, and use that and think about that in terms of your own neighborhood. Detroit may be the home of modern industrialization and poster child for deindustrialization, but it's also the home, one of the great homes for urban gardening. Detroit, in the country, for the urban gardening and everything. So I know things out. Those are the kind of things that I think are important. For most of this year, up until June, I worked on Bernie Sanders' campaign. And when Bernie Sanders was running for the Democratic nomination. And Bernie Sanders is considered to be a democratic socialist, you know, and a great deal of his ideas are instructive as we make a translation and what does it look like? What is the systems? What is the world we want to live in? The World Social Forum, which took place in Porto Alegre, and the ideas around the World Social Forum is making a world in which we all can live in. What does that look like? Hugo Chavez called it 21st century socialism, in a sense. But the idea of socialism, you find now that over 40% of young people, more than 40% of young people, who were involved in some way with the electoral process and the primaries and everything else, when mentioned the word of socialism, they have no problem with it. So there's a new idea around social. What does that mean? And what am I saying? We've been indoctrinated in such a way, whether it's in Canada, and the way in whether it's in the United States, certainly through the Red Scare and through the McCarthy eras and through the punitive era, moments that we're taking, through what Cuba has translated, all those moments over the 20th century. And the first discussion and the first thought that came for me, because all these governments in some sense had some way in which there was a new governments and where there was a collaboration along ideas around national identity. Nationalism was the first thing that I believe. After World War II, when you see the dissolve of the colonial powers after war, just and everything else, after World War II, you have a great upheaval that's happening before World War II around national identity. Colonies, most of the world had been colonized. Now those colonies were now saying that we want, this is our land, this is our oil, this is everything else. We want to use the resources for our own development. The first thing that happened, certainly after World War II, is the revolt in Greece, which was crushed in part by the U.S. The Italian governments after World War II were about to revolt in a socialist government, and the U.S. threatened to end food rations in Italy. All these things are happening. Paint a picture of this. In 1953, the U.S. overthrew a nationalist government in Iran, Mozandef, and installed the Shah of Iran. In 1954, they overthrew a nationalist government in Guatemala and installed a dictatorship. All these things are happening at the same time. You look at Latin America. Every single Latin American country from 1961 with the British military dictatorship, everyone from Peru to Ecuador, from every one of them had a dictatorship, military dictatorship. So you see that the question is always around, has been around national identity. And the ideas of the nation state come from the ideas of Machiavellian thought, which came place. But the first thing before the nation state was the city-states. The city-states that existed in Europe and everything, and the power of the city-state. So this evolution of thought, the ideas of Marx and Lenin are important. They are essential to understand the ideas around it. You cannot understand capitalism if you don't understand the ideas around, because Marx and Leninism is only an analysis of capitalism. Now Marx lived in the middle part of the 19th century, he couldn't foresee global capital and the way in which capitals rearranged themselves over that period of time. It's for us and further thought. But you look at the radicalization that happened at the part of the 20th century, early part of the 20th century. You had Eugene Debs, a socialist who ran for president from prison because he was jailed for sedition. Deal for sedition, ran for president from jail. Or you had Emma Goldman, the great woman who fought for all the radicals, and I gave you W.B. Du Bois, but many others. You know, A. Philip Randolph was a socialist when he was organizing the sleeping car porters for 12 years and everything. All the ideas that came out of this, you know. As I said, C.L.R. James wrote Black Jacobins, one of the great socialist historians of the 20th century, you know. He and Paul Robeson went around in Europe, imagine these great, two great, tall, majestic men, performing a play on Toussaint Louverture and playing out the Haitian Revolution. See, all these things, Du Bois and Robeson formed the Council on African Affairs, 1939, because they foresaw the liberation of movements liberating Africa after World War II. And then the Manchester Conference in 1944, where you had Padmore, you had C.L.R. James, you had Du Bois, you had all these great thinkers who were at their most at the point. There's a radical nature that I'm sure it finds itself in Canada in terms of that. And I'm saying when radical, the political radicalism that we don't often get there. Dr. King in 1952, he says, I'm more a socialist than a capitalist. Dr. King, this is before, this is a speech he made, a conversation he had with somebody before this. So all the ideas around changing, because there's a change in relationship. What does that relationship look like? We don't know what the change in the relationship is yet. I learned about the Cuban Revolution when I was 12, 13 years old. Because you know why? Because my parents' union was celebrating the Cuban Revolution in 1959. So the one thing is I heard the Cuban Revolution, what's happening here? And every moment in that, from that point on, I tried to find out more and more and more and understand that the Cuban Revolution in the context of world revolution. And what had happened before, what is happening now? Where do we place ourselves at this moment? And I didn't mean this to be instructional, but where do we place something? It's very important. As we see the images, you see the Workers' Party, you see the coup in Brazil right now, you know, overthrowing the Workers' Party. You see MST, the Landless Movement. Landless Movement in Brazil, they just had a conference, a Utopia Festival in June this year. Utopia said, the Landless Movement has placed over 400,000 landless families, more than 1.3 million people on land. And they were just having a festival, which we had a chance to go to, looking, demonstrating, and presenting what they did, finding new relationships, signing new relationships to each other through the changing relationships we had. How do you now institutionalize those relationships? How do we look for models in those terms of those relationships? The idea, when I was talking to someone else about Petrocaribe, which an idea, Hugo Chavez, Petrocaribe, discount oil to Caribbean countries. And if you put the money into infrastructure, the money you were supposed to repay back in the infrastructure, abolishing the loan, thinking. Those are the kind of relationships that people are yearning for. Those are the kind of relationships that people have developed over time. How do we now take those relationships, understanding that there are three things that are important? The planet, planet, and you know, equity, rights for gender, rights for women, and also for LGBT rights. We have to understand that. And how do we now manufacture and protecting the planet? We have to figure out how we do all those things and create something, another relationship. In the 21st century, with buildings that tell you we're bigger than God, because we can build stuff higher than God, taller than God, and with everything else. How do you now transform our own thinking in what we need to do? It's a process. Do we have to go to a scenario that's almost a doomsday process before we understand that we're the ones who have to save ourselves and save humanity?
Thank you. Danny?
Project. I'm on the Algebra Project's board of directors. And Bob Moses says, we had a conference about a year and a half ago, almost 2 years ago. He says that you give me strategic opportunities for the bottom quartile, and I raise the boat for all. I raise the boat for all students. Now, what this is very interesting. He says, if I have strategic opportunities for the bottom quartile of students, and he's using his algebra project, and it's a wonderful book, Math Literacy and Civil Rights. You know, a wonderful book, Bob. Because Bob's analysis it says, hey. There's never been a national agenda for education in the United States. Never been a national. There's all states' rights. Always been states' rights. So the state decides what they want to do and everything else. So there's these kind of different kind of modes in the various educational systems around there. You give me strategic opportunities for the bottom quartile, and I raised the boat for everybody else. You know, and now the whole thing is testing, which is not about anything. And there's been a revolt in places like Seattle and every place else around testing, around testing. So I think those are kind of movements where people are trying to find out, search through what does it mean? What does it mean to be a human being? What does it mean around educating our children? And what does it mean that in educating our children, as my Ms. Lumber, my third grade teacher said, and making them citizens?
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. Thank you so much. So if you want to just give a big shout out to Danny and as in terms of the class. So, okay, so we have to rush because he actually has another engagement at 7:30, but it's not too far from here, which is good. Toronto is small, everything's happening here. But we just want to thank all of you for coming out and making him feel very much at home, very much loved. Do you feel the love?
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
Because you give the love, that's why you get the love back. So I hope you've been inspired and we'll really think about the things that he's saying, because he's been around, he has a lot of life experiences, but again, you know, it's wonderful to be able to learn and to get the knowledge and the insight and wisdom from someone who has actually walked the walk. So again, thank you so much. Okay, well, hear this, some trouble.
I'm in process, you know? Look here, I'm always in process, you know. I says, when Harry tells a story when he went to Paul Robeson and said, Paul, all the things that happened. This is when Paul was 70 some years old and had gone through so much. He said, Paul, if you had to change anything in your life, would you change anything? He says, not one thing. He said, Harry, it's about the journey, who you meet, what you think, and what you see on the journey. It's a journey. And if you're in the right place, you don't have to apologize for anything. You know, you don't have to apologize for anything at all. And Paul, after being beaten up by the House on Un-American Activities and being alienated from the community that loved him, you know, all the community that loved him, says it's about the journey, and it's about your journey. And he was telling Harry at that, two men, and I said, and they would have been women there if it had been in 2000. The two men sat down in Abyssinia Church in 1955, toward the end. One, a 26, 27-year-old preacher, and the other, probably the most famous entertainer of his time at 29 years old, and said, how do we plan a movement? Boom. How do we raise money for movement? Boom. Let's go to the King of Sweden. Boom. He's a friend. Progressive and everything else. How do we mean? Just sat there. Sat around. There's a wonderful picture of the two of them sitting. They were only supposed to meet for a few minutes. They sat around and talked for 3.5 hours.
Wow.
Whew. And they were entangled in each other's life from that moment on until 1968, when King was assassinated, you know? And that's what it is, you know? And it's not a movement that they built. They saw the movement of people. When you see what I'm looking at the color change, you know, the Dream Defenders, Black Lives Matter. I'm looking at them. Where you going? I'm following you. I'm gonna say, let me see how I can, what I can add, what I can feel, what I can think. You know, when I saw all those young people on Bernie's case, saying, tell me what you're thinking. You know, Muslims, South Asians, you know, young blacks, young whites, Hispanic. I'm saying, well, what you thinking? Well, you see it, you know? And that's the real, that's where it is. Or following the Occupy movement. Create a whole nother another framework, 1% 99. The Occupy movement, you can't get away with it. You can't, it's there, it's new language. It's gonna, we're gonna erase the dictionary about 10 years from now, you'll see 1% 99, what does it mean? It never was there before, you know? But again, that's what we're looking for. I just wanna thank you.
Booklist.